underneath the KOFY TV studios, it's Creepy KOFY movie time. Tonight, comedian Eric Krasner, the Bay Area ghost busters, roving reporter Slob on the spot, the cave girl trivia challenge continues, sexy dancing by Hollywood, Creepy KOFY sides time with Dr. Scott Weitze, with the amazing cave girls, Fact Rat Weberly, and the Deadlies. I am Gina Seregina, and here is Balrog, and here is No Name.
Tonight's movie is a classic. Horrific, horrific piece of cinema.
Well, this is the thing. You know, we show movies here, and like, okay, this movie is based on real life events, actually containing real life footage of those events. So remember, like the Blair Witch, Amityville Horror, so, Friday the 13th, all those movies that were based on real life events.
Sure.
This is one of those movies, which always makes it extra freaky.
And it's interesting because this is actually a sequel. Tonight's movie is. The part one was actually called Cannibal
Appeasement.
Right,
yeah, I remember
that. Which just went right off the rails.
Filmed in Poland, right?
Yeah, I believe the first part of it.
But that, they had like a little small group of cannibals.
Anyway, it's
they're trying to appease them, but this will work out fine. We got it under
political
control.
Political analogy is, I
we
think,
gave them the prison population to eat. Right. It's all good.
The drinking word tonight is Professor Monroe.
That's right.
In whatever form, Professor Monroe, whatever, just whenever you feel like drinking. This movie is awful. There's going to be a lot of it cut out. I don't know what's going to actually make it through.
This is like the tester. Like, if you're like, dude, this is kind of crazy, and you want to see more, this is like a choose-your-own-adventure book. You can be like, I want to see the really fucked up shit.
If you've just killed your first cat, and you're like, wait, am I going to be a serial killer?
Yeah.
Watch this movie. If you get through it, and you're like, oh, man, I'm feeling kind of horny. Yeah. Then, yes, you are.
Search out the unedited one if you really want to be disturbed.
And then
this
you'll
is like,
know.
You know. It's like grade C. This is the movie. Let's start this shit now.
Just the start.
I just want to say once again that this is real footage of total savages ripping apart people and just like eating. Real footage of indigenous native peoples eating their local diet. Is what I mean to say.
What's weird?
Savages! Oh God!
Only in the eyes of outsiders. The question I have is, how come whenever there's cannibals, they always are like,
they're
like
frenzied.
That.
Yeah.
Like, why can't they just be like, oh, this is delicious? Yeah.
Well, you know what it is? I think human flesh is gluten free, and so they're like all into it. They're like,
would
oh my God!
Would you like some thighs? Why can't they just be enjoying their meal?
I mean, it's got to be frantic, dude. It's so unacceptable to eat people that, like, even in the middle of nowhere where everyone does it, they still think they're going to get caught and punished. So they're like, oh, my God, I'm eating Judy. I was just talking to her yesterday. Oh.
It's not like their plane crashed on the way back from the soccer tournament. These guys are eating people all the time.
That's true. It probably never gets old. Dude, how do we know what we're missing, okay? And this movie is going to really raise a lot of questions for you. What is a sex object? You know, I mean, trust me, you're going to learn a lot about yourself. And a lot about savages. I mean, primitive cultures, indigenous peoples watching this movie tonight.
A lot of questions will be raised.
Exactly.
That's true. You know, Professor Monroe actually spends about half of his time doing pornography. He was in the original Taboo movies, which are always fan favorites. The delightful, sexy tale of incest that we all grew up with. And now he's in.
I'm really just trying to grasp the fact that we just saw actual footage of a dude drinking someone else's blood and actual footage of Chaco laughing at the other guy for being such a pussy and freaking out about it. I mean, there's like two realities there. You see the horrific reality and then the reality of the kind of the Westerner going like, oh my God, and then the Chaco guy who's so macho, just so macho.
Chaco macho.
Going like, ah, what are you crying about, pussy? Look at it.
I am macho Chaco.
They're drinking blood.
Macho Chaco.
That's what we do down here. Savage!
That dude figured it out. I mean, he's living.
He's living on the edge, man. If you're living in an area where people eat people for no fucking reason, you are on the edge or in the tenderloin.
People.
One or the other.
People who eat people.
Yeah, crazy.
Gina, would you rather eat a monkey or a person?
I would eat both.
That makes sense. I mean, there's not a whole lot of difference.
Because if the ideal situation to eat someone is right after they ate an animal. You know what I mean? Like they eat a rodent and it's all in their stomach and then you're like, now I'm eating like the stomach with the rodent. It's like a human turducken. It's like a rodent that just ate a smaller animal in the human stomach.
It's
like
a manster.
Something crazy. Yeah, like you're eating it. You're like, I'm getting the protein of what a mouse eats, what that little bug ate, and what that human ate, which was the mouse. It's like, I'm getting the entire food pyramid right here by eating one human stomach. Plus, this is awesome.
With a lot less hair if you just eat the person.
Yeah, exactly. You don't got five food groups.
What do they call it? Shucking it? You know how you gotta take all the hair out?
Shucking it, man. Just eat that stomach, get some of that liver in your mouth.
Oh, it's an Asian fella. There's no hair at all. Let's get right to the barbecue. Finals.
That's right, you degenerates. It's your favorite game show ever.
Championship
round. You
got
the Price is Right was cool to get stoned to, and now you got this, the Creepy Coffee Trivia Challenge. It's genius television, seriously. You can admit that to yourself right now on your couch. It's amazing what you're seeing. Hot chicks playing for a championship, answering questions. I can't believe we're doing this, Ball Rock.
It's amazing.
Dirty Minds, I'm gonna give some clues. It's gonna sound like I'm talking about something completely filthy and dirty and raunchy, but guess
coconut.
What? I'm not.
Yes!
Toothpaste.
Yes!
This is for the final, ladies. Amen. This is for the final.
Two out of three.
If you win this, it's okay to take off your clothes and run around.
Absolutely.
I'm not saying it's mandatory, it's just okay. This is
but
a big
you kind
deal.
Of should, really.
You kind of should, yeah. Really. You know, that would be cool. Wouldn't it be cool?
It'd prove you a champion.
That's right. All right, so here we go.
Here are the three clues.
You have to push on me to get me inserted. You go to bed with me. You pound me before you bury your face in me.
A pillow?
That is actually correct!
I knew it! I knew that one! Come back.
All right, gather yourself.
I'm here. It's all right. We'll be fine. You're blocking me.
1-0.
1-0.
Jesus. Stop kidding me.
Don't cheat over there.
I usually come at night.
Oh.
I want to grab your family jewels. I'm
a robber?
That is absolutely correct! Oh my god! Where the f is the confetti falling from the sky?
You guys will never be forgotten.
That was it. All right, put your hands together. That was amazing. That was a game show.
This movie is so gross.
You know, I thought the use of the primitive sex toy was a little creative in the mud art. But when the dude beat the chick to death with the sex toy, I thought that was a little over the top. But who am I to judge savages?
Well,
I mean, primitive cultures, indigenous people. Who am I to judge?
It certainly went from loving to angry.
Sure, in like
pretty quickly,
pretty instantly. Yeah, but yeah. I mean, I don't know their culture. You know, I'm not an anthropologist. I don't understand.
Well, I think any ceremony that ends up with someone dead is probably not great.
Who knows? Who knows?
I'm pretty sure that. Why?
Sorry.
Why constantly? What have I done? God damn it. Everywhere on this show.
It's the talk of the stone dildo. It makes the chicks restless.
I understand. I mean, I get a little weird too.
It's primitive, yet you have to respect it because it's not our culture. I mean, even though it makes no sense,
I don't know that that's
it's totally
true
violent and completely fucked up. God forbid anyone says these motherfuckers should be wiped off the face of the earth because they're fucking savages.
Well, no, right. In today's,
no one would ever
in today's
say that.
PC
I would never
world,
say
right,
that. I would never feel that way. I mean, it's you have to respect those other cultures that literally rape chicks to death with a stone and beat them
with
in the
mud.
Head to death
right.
And then make a mud statue of it because they're
right.
Adding something to the future.
Yeah. I mean, you could take her out of that society. And, you know, she could clean or cook something somewhere and have a life.
Yeah. How come we don't have a fucking drone attack going on right now to these fucking people? And I'm sorry. I mean, just respect the culture. And just because it's different than mine means nothing. The shit that I'm into, believe me, they'd probably find offensive too.
Like smoking and masturbating.
Totally.
Freedom.
Yeah. Women voting, talking.
Well, let's not get crazy. There's some of it that's, there's some good points made on both sides.
This is a horrible movie called It's very hard to watch. We understand that.
You know that? Sorry.
No, go. There's so much to talk about in this movie. It's a little, I just find it fascinating that just at the point where like these college kids have no hope, they're gonna die in an instant, boom, a switchblade all of a sudden creates tribal peace. It's like, oh man. I mean, these guys are like running out of their lives if they have nine of them, is what I'm saying. This is
why you at all times carry with you a lighter and a switchblade, because whether it's running into primitives or falling into a time machine, if you end up somewhere and you pull out, ching, and you got fire, you're king.
True.
I'm magic, man. I'm making fire right here.
Switchblade.
And then you're like, I'm king. Wait, did one of you guys just sneeze? Oh, shit. And then you're dead. But for a while, you're living the life.
Mm-hmm. Remember, the more weapons you carry in life, the more your survival rate is going
to increase. No, just to fool the primitives. Yeah, the fire. Switchblade out of nowhere.
Mirror, you know?
The thing where you take your thumb off?
Yeah, you can bring like a hustler and be like, look at this. I'm what a god! Looks like. It's clean shaven. You know, they're like, oh! Your women have these too under that bush there.
Oh. That's the way you'd go?
Oh, pink lips. Oh. No. No feces clung to pubic hair. Oh.
I feel like the lighter might be a little safer.
You may notice this mountain of cocaine on my
God
head, man.
God damn it. We're at the point of the show now where we actually bring you some comedy. And tonight, we're happy and proud to have us in the cave, for your pleasure, Eric Krasner!
So I live on Walnut Street in Berkeley. For those of you who don't know, Walnut Street is where white people come from. I'm pretty sure. I'm not a scientist. I'm just going by the evidence I know. On my block alone, there are 3 French bistros, a walking shoe store, a juice bar, Pete's Coffee. Not a Pete's Coffee, the one Pete worked at. An acupuncturist, and a holistic dog boutique. A holistic dog boutique. Do you guys know how comfortable in life you have to be to shop at a holistic dog boutique? To buy fancy fake medicine for your dog? That means you've already bought real medicine for yourself, real medicine for your dog, fake medicine for yourself. And when it comes time to buy fake medicine for your dog, you feel like you can afford to splurge. No mass market echinacea bits for Rover, he's getting the handcrafted ones. I've spent most of the past year unemployed, but it's not actually so bad. For instance, I've stopped sleeping at night and started sleeping whenever. It's amazing how much sleep you can get when there's no point in being awake. Because I could be asleep at any hour of the day now. I'm never really sure if I am awake or just having a really uneventful dream. So unemployment's like the movie Inception, except even more boring. Unlike Inception, I couldn't tell 5 minutes in how it's gonna end. Like Inception, it lasts way too long and takes a lot of drinking to get through. Also, my friends keep coming up to me and trying to explain why it's not so bad. Dating while unemployed is probably the worst part. You'd be surprised how early in an OkCupid date it comes up. About 5 minutes into my last one, I found myself saying, I think of myself as a full-time stand-up comic. And I get it. I get why it's not attractive that I don't have a job. Like, I'm always borrowing from people. I'm always depending on people. I can't get your burrito. I can't get my burrito. It's not a peanut butter sandwich with only peanut butter on it. It's technically out of my price range. My main mode of transportation is literally the passenger side of my best friend's ride, you guys. I am a scrub. And I shouldn't get no love until I'm an economically independent entity. All right, that's it for me, guys. I've been Eric Krasner.
You know what's interesting about this movie, Balrog? It proves one of my theories. that man at one time could communicate with animals. Because if you think about like how these natives talk,
sit.
They're like, they're like grunting, and it kind of sounds like a crocodile. So it literally, what I believe is that crocodiles at some time taught these primitive people how to speak, and it was like the foundation of language as we know it. You know, I mean, and then
okay, you should not be allowed
years,
to talk for like 5 minutes.
No, you're saying, like,
that is by far the silliest
listen,
thing.
Listen,
I
know there's a lot of animal lovers watching. You love your animals. And you always go, I wonder what it'd be like to
the
talk
fountain
to animals.
Of knowledge is crocodiles.
I'm just saying.
Hey, bro, check it out. We did math.
I believe at one time.
Yeah, look at the stars. That shit's fucked up, right?
People could talk to animals. I think
what?
That this movie proves it. Because if you just take a second and listen to how the cannibals are talking, they sound like ants. I mean, they sound like a crocodile. They're like, you know, they sound like the animals around them. And I think at one time they could all talk to each other. Is all I'm saying.
You're wrong.
Weberly, you have a fact.
That's a very hard fact to follow, but true. I do have a fun fact. Primitive savages get a pretty bad rap in the media these days, but the truth is, there's more reported cannibalism in Arkansas every year than in the entire Amazon rainforest.
See, that's jingoism right there.
You don't know it. Yeah.
You don't know
it. I wonder how many xenophobes we're creating by showing this movie. Like, people are like, dude, I am never leaving Dublin, ever.
Let's ask an alligator.
Ever. Because I know out in Livermore, this is going on. Done.
I really appreciate that even though there's these two distinct groups of indigenous peoples at war with each other for however long, some in the trees, some live in the swamp, completely different, every single one of them has the golem's haircut.
Mm-hmm.
I appreciate that.
It was the fashion of the day, dude.
Is it just, it's like a mud thing?
I don't understand it. I just got to remind everyone that you just saw real life footage of a professor from NYU eating human organs. I mean, that's real. We're showing the real deal here tonight. We probably could get arrested.
And speaking of human organs, he also does porn. It was in the taboo series.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But I'm bummed.
Mm-hmm.
Sex parts. Is
used
what I'm
to
getting.
Eating human organs. We get it.
Right. Gina, what are your thoughts on the jungle?
To me, being in the jungle is exactly like celebrating New Year's Eve with my grandma. The stakes are very low. We can't talk about anything but the puddle she's sleeping in and also coconut.
You know, she can take things and just distill them.
Mm.
Into their core, their core essence.
Feeling that, man. Feeling it.
Hey, how's everybody doing?
Oh, dude, hey. Great, Slob.
All right. Check this out. I got something to solve something. I should have had this in the 20s.
Look here, see?
You know, back in the day, the gangsters, they would, you know, bootlegging and they were shooting each other up to sneak booze around because it's prohibition and everything, right?
Violence, man. Violence over alcohol. It's crazy.
And the police would come and the police have to shoot. But my idea is like, if instead of using machine guns, you could have water guns. And when the police come, you could have had wet t-shirt contests.
Oh.
And then the police would be distracted and you could hide all your booze. And the police would never know what's going on, right?
I understand.
You get what I'm saying?
I know what you're saying.
It's a good idea. So this is for world peace.
You're saying with more wet t-shirt contests in the world, there would be less gun violence.
Absolutely. That's what I'm saying.
I totally feel you, man.
And I thought about this because in Sausalito.
This seems like a kind of prohibition I can get behind.
Yeah, it's good. Babyface Nelson was in Sausalito for a short time as a bootlegger.
That's what you get, see?
I made a movie out of it.
You don't bootleg around here.
You should watch it.
San Francisco is a long way from Chicago, but during federal prohibition, a little bit of the Windy City blew into Sausalito. In February 1932, Lester Joseph Gillis escaped from Juliet Prison in Illinois. Shortly after, this hardened Chi-Town gangster was bootlegging booze within spitting distance of the Golden Gate. You might know Lester by his better-known public name, Babyface Nelson. Born in 1908, by the age of 13, he had already shot a person and spent time in penal school for auto theft. Running with the gangs in Chicago, he made a living robbing banks and committing home invasion robberies. Finally arrested, his association with the criminal underground helped him escape and relocate to the Golden State. Sausalito had more than its fair share of rum runners, speakeasies, and backyard stills. Babyface made himself at home and applied his particular business sense to the hooch trade. In 1932, he became a member of the John Dillinger Gang and went on a wild tear robbing banks, thus landing Babyface with the honor of being public enemy number one. He was killed by the FBI in November of 1934. That's it for Slob on the Spot.
We've decided not to show a 4-minute scene of them killing and butchering a turtle because the following people would get upset if we did. No, literally, dude, it was 4 minutes long.
I will remember you. Will you remember me? Don't let your life pass you by. Weep not for.
You got to see the unedited version of this movie.
You don't have to.
No.
Man,
it's rough.
Woo!
Woo! It's rough.
I think it's just safe to say that if we just saw that just showed that scene where the turtle gets butchered, that literally this entire station would be burnt to the ground.
Weberly, you have a fact.
Okay, yeah, sure. A fun fact, historically, cannibalism has been driven by either extreme famine or weird religion, but in modern times, over half of all cases of cannibalism, the suspect reported simple curiosity as the motive for his foul deed.
Hmm. After seeing that turtle get butchered, I'd probably rather eat a person.
All I know is it just seems like so much work.
Mm. Yeah, survival. It's like, dude, you're in the jungle, you gotta actually work for food. It's like... Forget it, I just dive headfirst into an alligator or a crocodile.
Didn't we kill the Indian so we wouldn't have to do this?
I'd be like, ooga chaka chaka! Ah!
That's right, it's the time.
Yep, 60 seconds of horniness where we make dreams come true.
Well, we don't.
Well, the girls do. But if you've ever wanted to masturbate to a beautiful woman with a mask of Abraham Lincoln on, tonight is your night, congratulations. Our very special
Clock's
guest,
ticking.
Hollywood, W-O-U-L-D. Twist. It's here for, it's Hollywood! 60 seconds of horniness, go!
We have with us the real-life Ghostbusters.
Awesomeness,
Bay Area
man.
Ghostbusters!
Woo! Bay Area yeah. Ghostbusters!
It is such a pleasure to be here. Thank you, guys. Love No Name, love Bell Rock, and we especially love the Cave Girls.
Yeah.
Love the Cave Girls, big fans of the show. We don't like to get ghost calls on Saturday night because we're at Saturday at 11 o'clock. We're watching this TV show right here. Creepy Coffee Movie Time.
And it's gotta be
love
such
that.
An exciting time.
Thank you, brother.
To be a Ghostbuster after 9/11 with all the terrorism going on. Now you can hunt Osama bin Laden again.
Sure.
You get a movie made about it. I mean, it's gotta be an exciting time, right?
Yes, it is.
Yeah,
it is.
Fighting the ghost terrorists and just waging the holy war after life, just never ending terror war.
This is what you're gonna do? What
are
you
saying,
what are you guys
man?
Up to?
I mean, it's awesome.
Well, we've been up to a lot of things. We're winding down our convention season this year. Next year we'll be at WonderCon, San Diego Comic-Con.
Oh, yeah.
We will be at Wizard World in Sacramento, Big Wow Comic Fest. We are going to be releasing our new Ecto Hearse December 7th at the San Jose Convention Center Toy Show.
Now, a big question is, because if people are gonna watch this, They're gonna see your equipment and stuff, and they're gonna be like, dude, I gotta get in on this. How do you get recruits? How do you?
You just come over to Facebook.
I just heard something.
Facebook Bay Area Ghostbusters. Look at us on Facebook or BayAreaGhostbusters.com. But we're more active on Facebook. We have a large Facebook crowd. And so
are you actively searching out recruits? Because I guarantee you there's a bunch of dudes right now that are high on their couch going, I want in on that.
Oh, yeah.
We are always looking for new recruits.
They're like
always
right
looking.
Because that guy on the couch is going, that's my link to party with Ray Parker Jr. Yeah. Right there.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
Those guys.
Now, if someone joins, are they guaranteed to see ghosts?
Only if they're high.
All right. Well.
Is there a strong correlation between stoners and ghosts? I mean, like, when you guys get called, and you're like, dude, you're not seeing ghosts, you're just high.
Right.
And they're like,
go throw some water on your face.
It happens, man. It happens.
On occasion. That's all right, man. That's all right. But do you guys actively take calls?
Well, we take calls, yeah. In fact, while we're on commercial or during the movie tonight, we're going to be out in San Francisco taking a couple. We'll come back. You know why? Because we want to party with them cave girls.
Oh, yeah.
All night long.
The cave girls are real. They're not ghosts. They're just not here right now.
Well, we like to bust ghosts, and then, you know, we can bust cave girls, too.
I like your focus on the booty, dude. That's That's what this show really
dead
is all about.
Dead or alive, it's where it's at.
It's all good.
Now, just a couple other quick questions about you here. Is Dianne Feinstein gonna outlaw these things?
Probably.
Probably. Look at that, man. Looks deadly, you gotta outlaw. I just wanna say, man, it's I feel safer knowing that you guys are around.
Well, thank you very much.
You know,
it makes me feel
much.
A little bit more sane, and I can sleep soundly because I know that if there are ghosts, you guys are gonna handle it.
Exactly.
Glad you're on our side, fellas.
That's right.
So Facebook?
Facebook, Bay Area Ghostbusters.
There you go.
There you go. Look us up.
Track them down, be their friends, like them, love them. Yeah. Thanks, fellas.
I see what those college kids are doing. They're trying to like get on one cannibal tribe's side by cooking the other tribe of cannibals alive, like doing the prep work for the other tribe. Very interesting technique to achieve peace.
They're trying to stir some revenge. They're trying to get them to fight.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, it's like, so when the other tribe comes, like, look, we cooked your whole tribe in a hut, dig in, we got a barbecue going.
Well, I think it's more for the ones who don't get burned that they make watch them hump will then go fight the other ones. I think they want to.
Did we show that scene in this movie where they have sex on the hut?
Well, it's not in there, but if you go see the real quick, after they burn them all dead,
they put them in
the guy and the girl hump
on top
in front of the rest of the surviving.
But not only that, on top of the roof of the hut that they just burnt.
On the bones of their relatives.
Yes.
They have intercourse and make everyone in the village sit there and watch.
Dude!
Which, I mean, by the way, I used to think that Patton pissing in the Rhine was the coolest move ever.
Oh.
Humping your chick in front of your fallen enemy might be better.
I mean, this is what's going on when you go to a fancy college, obviously. Like, this isn't
community
college,
right?
Shit. This is like Ivy League, like, I'm going to go to Africa for 6 years and, like, you know, like, was it Peace Corps, whatever you sign up for. I mean, this is some crazy stuff, man. This is what college is all about. Like,
it's got to sound hella cool translating it into a different language, you know? I will lay my woman down and have sex with her on the bones of your family.
Yeah, they're like, oh, man.
That shit's getting carved in rocks, you know?
Oh, man.
They'll be like, man, those dudes were crazy.
Yeah, crazy people from New York City. That's how they do it in the NYU. That's a crazy college, man.
The only downside, of course, now is all those villagers are going to get millions when they call the Kuvara
Law. No!
1-800-4-INJURY, 1-800-4-INJURY.com. No case too big, no crime too small. Thankfully, in this case, because this is going to have to be like a class action thing.
They're going
to
sue like the whole fraternity, you know, like the whole.
Well, dude, they should be suing the studio that paid these clowns to go make the documentary. Right. The college.
The airplane that brought them here.
Dude, everyone these people have ever met should be
getting sued.
People
that are talking about their footage like us. I mean,
and on the good side, I mean, they're savages, so, you know, they'll get like 14 pairs of jeans and a bunch of, you know,
Michael
like,
Jackson t-shirts.
A bunch of t-shirts that are like, Rangers win the World Series. So, it won't be, it's not such a bad payoff anyway. But it sounds like a win-win, is my point. 1-800-4-INJURY, 1-800-4-INJURY.com.
It's amazing to see the culture clash happening in this movie right now. Unbelievable. Real life footage.
Culture clash with Boy George.
Mm-hmm. Boy George.
Those people are such jerks.
Dude, I gotta go back to college. What are you talking about, man? I'm learning all kinds of cool stuff about other cultures. Like, the old people in this culture, the cannibal culture, just wander off. It's like, oh, the old people wander off in this culture to die. It's like,
well
that's an interesting concept.
Don't we wish that still existed in society?
I'm just saying, maybe this culture has something to offer.
What happened to Grandpa? I don't know. I think he's dead.
Totally. We dropped him off in Golden Gate Park. I have no idea. I gave him a bag of weed and some heroin and some needles. And
hopefully
whatever,
he's decomposing peacefully somewhere.
Yeah. He's riding those buffalo. He thinks he's like a cowboy or something. Who knows, man? But interesting concept nonetheless.
Gina, what would your documentary be?
It would be about my day, like I get up, I braid my hair for close to 1 hour, and then I stop and say hello to everybody, and then it turns out that I can't leave, so you know, I Windex these, and then that's it.
Yeah, I'd probably watch that.
Yeah, I'd watch that, definitely.
These people are jerks.
What?
The students, they're jerks.
Well, they're rich college kids, dude. Listen, they're all on drugs. Yeah, they're all entitled. You know, they're like, they don't have to have a real job. I mean, you know, you think about
it. That's what I mean. Like, these kids are clearly, these filmmaker kids, yeah, they're not going to, like, you know, a Cal State.
No, yeah, exactly. When you go to, when you
guys are like at USC, NYU.
Yeah, you go to City College, you know, you're going to work at McDonald's afterwards to try to pay your $10 a unit.
You don't feel like you can own the lives of all these people.
You're taking basic math. You're like, dude, what is 4 plus 4? I have
it's no actually still
idea.
Called math.
Yeah, you're frustrated. Yeah. These guys are going to NYU. Right. It's an Ivy League. You're either going to become the president of the United States of America, or you can join the Peace Corps and do what these guys are doing. I mean, it's
slaughter
either
people.
Way, you're slaughtering people. Right? I mean, you know. So, I mean, it's just, listen, don't judge them.
Jerks.
Don't, you know, like, don't judge them. They
Jerks.
Come from a different class of society, you know,
Jerks.
Just because we don't understand and they got all the good drugs and we don't.
Jerks.
Whatever. I mean, think about the difference between, like, learning history about, like, raping and pillaging people and then actually doing
Jerks.
It in college. You're like, yeah, I've done that. Come
Jerks.
On, man. Who hasn't killed a whole village of third world natives? You know, I mean, that's what they talk about when they're playing golf and shit, bro.
Eden Alexander here, adult film star, and we're back with advice from an adult star, and here is our next question.
Hi, Eden. What are the best kinds of condoms to use?
What are the best kinds of condoms to use? Well, this is a personal opinion, but I am a webcam girl, so I use condoms regularly to protect my toys and keep them clean. So in my personal experience, there's two different brands that work great. One is Durex Extra Thin, for obvious reasons. It's very thin, but they're very durable. I never have them break on me, and they don't taste bad. Another option is the Trojan Magnum. It's a classic, but if you are a gifted man, you should have no problem with these, and fear not, they're very durable as well. So give them a try, and make sure to always have safe sex.
Science!
Yes! Jaw-dropping science ball.
Here he is, the Ron Jeremy of science, woo. Dr. Scott Weiss.
Oh, the internet.
Scott, tonight's movie, very, like, culturally eye-opening and stuff. I'm learning a lot about different cultures, the values that they have and everything. My question, are there really cannibal tribes in the Amazon?
So, against all odds, this movie is actually based on something that really happened. So in this movie, they mention the Yanomamo tribe. That's a real tribe.
There's actually talking about Mama.
There's Yanomamo. A Yanomamo tribe actually on the border of Venezuela and Brazil. They actually are cannibals, sort of. So they don't eat other tribes. They actually eat the bones of their ancestors to keep it all in the family, if you will. Also, just like this movie, it turns out that they were first identified as a really violent tribe. There's a very famous ethnography written, and wow, I'm using a lot of big words here, ethnography written in the 1960s about how violent they were. There was also, much like this movie, a book that came out later that said, well, a lot of that stuff wasn't true. They were actually manipulated into looking more violent than they really were. So it's a complicated issue. You should, like, totally look it up on the internet. What's really
Thanks,
interesting,
Scott.
So turn off this show and go to the internet. That's perfect.
Good looking at yourself.
Way to sell the TV show.
Google it.
Nice job. So from a biological perspective, that the Yanomami actually taught us something really interesting about human development. So it turns out if you grew up if you were born into a very violent society, you are much more likely to be left-handed than right-handed. So it turns out that 22.6% of the Yanomami people are actually left-handed. And in peaceful cultures, it's more like 3.4%. In America, if you're curious, it's about 10%. So why would that be? Why would being left-handed in a violent culture make any sense at all? So it turns out when you're in a fight, being left-handed is a huge advantage if it's rare, right? If you're having one encounter, one fight, you ever get in a fight with a left-handed person? It actually feels weird for the first couple punches, right?
Southpaw.
Like Rocky Balboa, right? So it turns out that if you're in a stressful environment, that stressful environment actually changes the human developmental wiring and makes you more likely to be left-handed. And therefore, violent cultures have lots of lefties, and very peaceful cultures have very few lefties. Science.
This makes me hate all documentary filmmakers. That's how angry I am about this.
What are you talking about?
This is awful.
It's too real is what it is, isn't it?
You shouldn't be doing that.
Listen, you can't judge a whole society of rich white guys that go to an Ivy League college based on the action of four people.
I have no idea how hard it is for rich white men.
Yeah, I mean, come on, I know a couple of them, man. And, you know, it's like, they're not all like this. Most of them are, but, you know, it's like, it's in their blood. It's in their nature. It's in their DNA to exploit people. Rape and pillage.
Yes,
I mean, it's just,
we're going to kill the natives.
It's what the white man does, you know? It's like, it's whatever. They don't care. They don't understand. It's like they go to college. Like, they're good people. Growing up, kids, high school. And then when they get to that college and start getting all that education, all of a sudden they're like, we need to go conquer some people, whether it be by creating a massive corporation and fucking them over that way, or starting a war, or just going down and filming some shit and just killing people for the fuck of it. I mean, that's basically what they do once they get that education, dude. That's what a college degree means. When you go and see that thing, that piece of paper in your boss's office, that basically means he went to college and he knows how to fuck people up. That's all it means. He will fuck up your life somehow.
Hey, Gina, why do so many people say the cannibal Holocaust never happened?
Because I didn't.
Oh, Gina. This movie's made me upset and nauseous.
Dude, that was a messed up question, bro.
What?
That was like.
I've seen the footage, happened.
But listen, dude, like, I don't want to become one of those politically incorrect shows, okay?
Yeah,
I don't want to cross that line.
Yeah, heaven forbid.
Yeah, I don't want to go there. We don't need to stoop to that level.
Right.
We're doing fine on our own.
You don't want to talk about more butt stuff?
Jesus Christ, bro. What happened to my hair this episode, bro?
We've been through a lot. I'm not surprised.
I've seen all this violence and real life footage of people eating people and animals getting mutilated. And it's so Toto Calillo. Anybody?
Vio con Dios?
Is that song, I Eat Cannibal? It's incredible. That was Toto
Calillo. Oh, Tannenbaum.
Nobody knows what I'm talking about. That,
I
that
certainly
doesn't,
do
that doesn't
not.
Stop me from talking. Never.
Clearly. The thing about the people out
Fred Durst,
in the
Limp
forest.
Fred Durst, Limp Bizkit, I know Limp Bizkit.
The savages, at least they are who they are.
You know what, you're right.
What's worse is these people from NYU talking about, oh, we're advanced, we're whatever, doing way worse stuff.
They're strutting around going like, right. I have a house on Park Avenue and a Bentley.
Who's the real savage? Maybe it's you.
That's
maybe
right.
It's you.
Yeah, you
think
with
about
your college
that.
Degree, reading all your books, getting learned, running the businesses.
Think about
the message
that.
Of this movie is not just about different cultures coming together.
It's
in an
also
anthropological
that
kind
we're
of
we're never going to survive unless
we get a little cannibal. Yeah, dude. I mean, think about this, man. Like, right now is the time of night when you start going, would I eat somebody?
Well,
are the savages the cannibal, or is society the cannibal?
Especially because we're about to watch Cheaters, which only reinforces
Exactly. Because listen. You sit there and go, man, there's no way I'd fucking eat somebody. Fuck that. But then you're like, wait, I eat pussy. And Cheaters going, I suck dick. You're one step closer.
So you're saying that you're just a jaw close away.
You're just the tongue and the throat. It's like you're living on a prayer. You're halfway there.
You're a lock and rip away
exactly.
from being
All
a
you have to do is if that tongue turns into a bite, then you're literally eating pussy.
Well, there's something for all of us to chew on.
It's something.
Yeah.
Yeah, man, I know they're gonna edit a lot of this out, but look for it on YouTube. Make sure you check the unedited version of this movie. It's totally disturbing. Crazy. You guys watch the show, you're why we're here. It's Creepy Coffee Movie Time 7!